So the impetus for pipelines was that we realized how important notebooks are to the data scientist workflow. You know, to some degree, you can think of the data, like the Jupyter notebook, as the benchtop for data scientists. You know, that's where they run their experiments. That's where they iterate on ideas, play with the data set, play with features. And Truss is really supposed to be the easiest way for you to take a model that is kind of stuck or confined inside a notebook and turn it into a server via Truss. And then you can do a lot of things with that server. You can deploy it on AWS. You can deploy it on your own infrastructure. You can deploy it on Baseten. But the goal of Truss is to act as this packaging layer. And what we realized with the initial version of Truss was that data scientists would work inside of their notebook. They would develop their model. And then when they wanted to create a Truss, they could use the make Truss function that we provide inside of Truss. But that function isn't really flexible in the sense that maybe your model needs some very specific pre-processing, or it needs some very specific post-processing, or maybe there's a really unique way that your model expects data input. And with the original version of make Truss, to create a Truss, to create a scaffold, you would have to, you know, pass your model into make Truss and then navigate outside of your notebook. You'd have to open up the generated scaffold. You'd have to open it up in an IDE like this, and then you have to change it, and then you have to run it all over again. And that just wasn't conducive to the data scientist workflow, right? Like, we don't want them going outside of the notebook if everything they're doing is inside their notebook. So pipelines is our solution to this problem. And I can walk through an example here where, at a high level, what pipelines lets you do is it lets you define a model, not just as a model file or model object, but rather as a function that wraps that model. And so in this function, you can, we expect that you take in a dictionary because it's a request object, a request that's coming in. And the function takes in that request and then does some things to it, whatever it is that you want it to do, passes it in through the model, however it is that you define that. You know, maybe does some post-processing on top of that model output, and then turns that model output into a dictionary that can then be, you know, serialized as JSON and returned from the server. And what this helps you do is, instead of navigating outside of your notebook to go and update your Truss with the specific pre-post-processing that you needed, you can just do that inside your. And then when you want to make your Truss, you just pass in this function instead of this model, this function that wraps the model, and then we do some magic and we figure out what needs to be serialized, and then we turn that into a full-fledged server inside your notebook. You never have to leave. Yeah, so let's work through this example. So this is a notebook. You know, this is like what we spend all day in, right? We're just trying out ideas and playing around with stuff. And, you know, I import Truss, I import some helper, you know, modules that I need. And in this particular example, you know, Stable Diffusion is all the rage. So I want to do some stuff with Stable Diffusion. I want to, you know, do some pre-processing, post-processing, turn Stable Diffusion into an API that, you know, maybe my company or my team or my side project can use. So I import Torch, you know, I import diffusers as well. And, you know, I set up the model, and I'm currently on a GPU instance. So I push it to CUDA. And so now I have this scheduler, which is an input to my model, and I can tweak the scheduler. You know, maybe I want this to be, you know, 0.0009 instead of 0.0085, because that might, you know, influence how the model generates images or a specific way. So we let this run. It's pushing to CUDA, which always takes some time. And I have this helper function here that I defined, because instead of returning, I want my model server to return a base64 encoded string that represents this image. You know, and maybe this is because my app just expects it that way. You know, the front-end engineers on my team want the image this way instead of, let's say, an image file or a link to an image. And so I have this convert to B64 function, which takes in an image, you know, saves the image in this like buffered pool, and then encodes that, and then returns that encoded string. I load that in, and here's my like main function. You can think of this as the entry point to my model server. I'm calling it generate, but I could call it anything really. And like I said before, it takes in a variable, which is a dictionary, which is the request, the JSON, a serializable request that's coming into the model server. And in this case, the server or this function expects request to have a prompt key. And it also expects to have a size key. And if you don't have a size key, we just, we use the default of 512. And obviously the prompt is what you want your image to have. This is the input to Stable Diffusion. And the size is how large you want this image to be. We do some pre-processing here. And this is a good example of something that you might want your model server to do that in the previous version of Truss would have required you going through that very long route that I was describing, where the size needs to be divisible by 8. And this is a restriction that the Stable Diffusion library, the diffusers library, imposes on us. So we need to do a little bit of pre-processing here, just make sure that the size is divisible by 8. We generate a seed. We have a generator, which, creates a really random seed for us, essentially. And then we, pass our prompt and our size, the size of the generated image through the model. And then we convert that output into the base64 string that we defined up here. And then we return that base64 string in a dictionary, with a key response. So we can just, run that. And I import a truss from above. So what I can do now is I can just go truss.make_truss and then pass in this function that wraps my model. And when I do that, I get a warning that truss identifies some objects in GPU memory, which is expected. But now I have a scaffold. I have this variable, which is really a truss. It's a handle to a truss. And I can do a lot of different things here. I could take this scaffold, this handle, and I could deploy it to Baseten. I could get a Docker image out of it so that I could deploy it on, let's say, a Docker repository or a container repository. But in this case, I'm just going to run server predict, which locally runs the scaffold as a server. And I pass in a dictionary, just like generate expects, and it has a key prompt. And the prompt is man on moon. And I can run that. And it might take a second. But that function generate is being run. And all of the pre-processing and post-processing that I did, pre-processing to check the size and post-processing to convert it to a base64 string happens. And I get this response, which is my base64 encoded man on moon. That's Stable Diffusion. The goal here is really just to make model apps easier, but also how do we build more tools in the toolkit for a data scientist such that their lives and the people that they work with are significantly easier at work. And I think a good chunk of that comes into just having a really great developer experience. And so we really spent a lot of time thinking about, what is the best way for a user to interact with this functionality, with the pipeline functionality? What is the most easy to understand concepts here? Really, this is just a function and it expects a very specific input, which is this dictionary. And that has all the information that you can define, that you want to define. And then you can do anything that you could do inside this dictionary, inside a function. You could send an email and make an API call and run a model and save it to the local file system, wherever this is running. And then you just return a response and you can pass that function into make truss and it turns it into a full-fledged server. That is, that can work on major, instance providers like AWS or GCP. We're based on. So yeah, we're really excited about how this could be used. And I think I'm very hopeful that it's makes the lives of data scientists easier when they're working inside of their notebooks, which is, like I said in the beginning, the modern day benchtop. So.